with my head lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you.
Good morning and welcome to worship Woodlawn Without Walls. It's a joy to be with you this morning or whenever it is that you're tuning in for worship. Remember, in-person worship has started here at Woodlawn. We're on our third week this coming Sunday. But don't fret, our 8:30 online services will continue to premiere as scheduled. Our in-person services start at 10:45 in the worship center. Many have been asking when our sanctuary services will start, and this is really dependent upon our volunteers. We need help with positions like ushers, greeters, and tech crew. If you have questions about what those positions entail or what that might look like, please call the church office. We could use your help to make this worship service happen. Coffee Fellowship will be immediately following this service today, and I'll post a link in the comments towards the end of the service, or you can find that link in your newsletter. You can find more information about these announcements as well as others at woodlawnumc.net and by clicking on the news tab. Let's begin our time together today with our call to worship. This is a call and response. I invite you to join in with me with the words on your screen. God of all mercy and love, you have promised us your Son, the hope of our salvation. We offer up to you all that is wrong within us, for we long to be led into gladness.
We are prisoners of our own brokenness,
with hearts and minds and bodies in need of wholeness.
Come, Lord Jesus, live in us.
God hears our voices, sees our needs, and loves us, offering us the gift of forgiveness through Jesus Christ.
God offers us harmony with ourselves, our friends, our world, and most especially with our God.
Let us worship together. Please be in an attitude of prayer for our opening prayer. Dear God, we have been hurting too long. There's too much silence, too much pain. Won't you help us? Won't you heal us? Help us let go of figuring out the past. Let go of who's right and who's wrong. Instead, let us feel Christ embracing us so that we might be better with each other. Let us find a common ground where love heals all wounds. Help us trust that you can heal and that we can change. Bring us to you, bring us together. For we know that by your sweet mercy, all things are possible. In Jesus' name, amen. Our moment for mission today is Derby Circles. Derby Circles is an empowerment program for those living in poverty who wish to change their situation by setting goals, formulating action plans with a caring community. Your financial contributions today help provide the circle leaders the support and encouragement needed to help them reach their goals. Some of those goals are things like reaching high school diplomas, college graduation, home ownership, debt reduction, and improved credit scores. Thank you for considering giving today to this special mission. We give as a reflection of our faith. We give because we care. We care about our community. We care about each other. We care about the world. You're invited to give today by clicking on the link that is shared with this post here on Facebook, or by going to woodlawnumc.net and clicking on the giving tab, or by mailing your gifts here to the church. Let us pray a blessing over our offering today. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. God, we thank you for the privilege to participate in your acts of kindness and love here on earth. May these gifts we give today truly become instruments of your purpose here in our church, our community, and around the world. Amen.
Thank you.
As we come together in prayer this morning, if you have a prayer request that you would like for us to be lifting up not only today, but throughout the week, write that in the comments so that your church family can be praying for you. Let's go to God now in prayer together. Oh, God of compassion, if you kept a record of our sins, who could stand? We come before you with our brokenness, our wounds for all to see. We bring our anger, our bitterness, our unwholesome talk, our deceitfulness. We try to do good, but sometimes we fail. We choose to do wrong, and sometimes we succeed. Keep your promise to forgive us, gracious God. We confess to you completely. Without you, we have no hope, but your forgiveness washes it all away. Make us new by your word, by this nourishment of communion we will share today, by our communion with you and our communion with each other. May these words we hear today be nourishment for our souls and guidance for the living of our daily lives. May we be reflections of your truth and mercy. And God, we think of those who are sick, those who are receiving medical treatment, those who are grieving, those who are discouraged or searching and seeking for you. God, we lift those names now. God, for those names who have been spoken, for the names that rest on our hearts, for those names that have not been shared but are in need of prayer, we lift them up to you, God, knowing your love, your compassion, your mercy encompasses all, and you hear our prayers. God, we ask all this as we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. We continue our Lenten series today, Facing the Cross. We faced fear. We faced temptation. Today, we turn to face one another in reconciliation, to face especially those with whom we might have conflict or unresolved anger. Our first reading today comes from Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus. Bryce reads our scripture today.
Our first scripture today comes from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 25 through 32. So then, putting away falsehood, let all of us speak the truth to our neighbors, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil. Thieves must give up stealing. Rather, let them labor and work honestly with their own hands, so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up, as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you were marked with a seal for the day of redemption. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ has forgiven you.
Reconciliation is a recurring theme through the broad narrative of the Bible, such as Jacob's return home to reunite with his brother Esau, the one he had tricked out of his inheritance, remember? Or the tender scene as Joseph reveals his identity finally to his brothers and his father there in Egypt, then invites them to stay and live out the famine in Egypt where they will have plenty. The Bible reminds us that reconciliation is possible even after the worst of family situations. Jesus offers instruction on reconciliation in his Sermon on the Mount found in the Gospel of Matthew. Again, Bryce reads for us our scripture today.
Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 through 24. You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, "You shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment. But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, 'You fool,' you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift."
Jesus makes clear that temple worship, that worship that makes one at one with God, isn't truly possible until one has an at-one-ment with their relationships here on earth. Remember, Jesus is addressing a form of worship that is centered around sacrifice. This gift at the altar that he speaks of, that isn't like us putting a check in the plate. No, in Jesus's day, an offering, an animal sacrifice or the sacrifice of a measure of grain in the temple, this was the principal act of worship itself. This was the very thing that one did in order to please God, to show adoration to God, and to seek a relationship with God. So this passage, Jesus is telling his disciples, in effect, before you begin your worship, before you seek time with God, go straighten things out with anyone with whom you are angry. The passage from Paul reminds us that it's not the feelings of anger that are problematic. The truth is, God made each one of us with these feelings in God's own image. It's human to feel angry. God, the God of the Bible, at times would become angry with God's people, like when God speaks with Israel in Isaiah 54, "In overflowing wrath, for a moment I hid my face from you, but with everlasting love I will have compassion on you." As persons created in the image of God, we feel anger from time to time. The trouble isn't feeling angry, but it's nursing and holding on to those feelings of anger. In our reading from Ephesians this morning, Paul advises, be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. Now, at first we might think this might be in conflict with Jesus' instruction from the Sermon on the Mount, that anger at a brother or a sister is as serious of an infraction of the commandments as murder. It might be helpful for the briefest of Greek lessons here. In the original Greek, there are two words that are translated as anger in the Bible. One is thumos, which is described as being like a flame of burning straw. It blazes up hot and just as quickly dies down. I grew up in western Kansas. We had a lot of tumbleweeds out there. And in the spring, we would make towers of these tumbleweeds and we would burn them. And when you lit them, they flashed hot and high like you had poured gasoline on them. But in just literally minutes, that great fire was reduced down to a little bit of gray ash. That's thumos. Now, there's another word for anger. The other word is orge. Orge is the resentment and the hurt that we nurse, just like we might stoke a fire that we want to keep going so that it will not go out. It smolders there in our soul. This is the anger that we brood over and will not allow to subside, orge. Resentment. Grudges that have a way of becoming permanent when we let them fester. This is the anger that refuses to be reconciled. This is the anger that plots revenge, right? You see, thumos is in the air and it's over. Orge is in the heart and it lingers. Paul's advice is very practical. To be human is to get angry at times, thumos, an outburst that flames up quickly and dies away. Paul suggests to be angry, but not to sin. That is, not to allow that flash of anger to take up residence in the heart and dwell there, to become a festering, smoldering resentment, an orge. Jesus offers a gospel of reconciliation for anyone who might be nursing an orge type of resentment. He teaches his disciples in the Sermon on the Mount that if they are going to seek relationship with God, first they need to face one another and seek reconciliation with one another, to be reconciled to one's brother or sister, and then to come and offer their gift in the temple. Before one can face God, Jesus says, one must face one another in reconciliation. In the silence of the next moment, and in the authenticity that we seek to come before God, I invite each one of us to just think of someone. Think of someone right now, a person with whom your relationship might be strained or even broken. It's probably someone you haven't spoken to or spoken a kind word about in a long, long time. Is it a friend? A former friend? Is it a family member? Think of that person for a moment. Now, resist. Resist for now the temptation to think, well, it's their fault. They're the ones who won't speak to me. They'll just hang up if I try to call them on the phone. See. No. Let that die away for a moment. After all, you're not responsible for the outcome if you seek reconciliation. Christ and Paul just ask that you take the initiative. Christian leader and writer Jim Wolstenholme offers, I think, great insight for the necessary steps that each one of us can take toward reconciling a broken relationship. The first step, Wolstenholme says, is to look inward. In broken relationships, we must first honestly ask ourselves how we have contributed to the breach. How we have contributed to the break in this relationship. What did we say? What did we do or fail to do? Look in. That's the first step. And it's only after we complete this first step with some time and some thought that we move on to the second step. And Wolstenholme says the second step is, once one has looked in, then look out. Assess how the other person contributed to the conflict. What did they do or say or fail to do or say? Now, this may sound like a much easier step, right? It's always easier to recognize what someone else has done wrong. But this step requires that we also be ready and prepared to forgive that person for their actions. Wolstenholme defines forgiveness as granting a pardon for an offense and to treat the offender as if the offense had never occurred. Forgiveness is granting a pardon for an offense and treating the offender as though that offense had never occurred. This is the way that God forgives us. And we must be absolutely clear in our own hearts and minds that we are ready to treat the person with whom we are broken as though the offense had never occurred. That's what looking out is about. And it's when we have reached that place in our own hearts that we're finally ready for the third step. And Wolstenholme says that is communication. This is the face-to-face part. But we reach that face-to-face part after we have looked inward, we've looked outward, and we have prepared ourselves by forgiving the person. In your conversation with that other person, first communicate how this conflict has made you feel and that you would like things to be different than they are currently. And it's important in that conversation to also accept responsibility for your own part in the breach that has occurred. Now, it's human nature that when one does that, when one accepts responsibility for their part, to expect the other person then to also accept partial responsibility. However, Wolstenholme says we must also be fully prepared that the other party may not accept partial responsibility. What then? Well, this is why the previous step of forgiveness is so necessary. As hard as it is to do so, that's why we must reach a place in our own heart where we can treat the offender as though the offense had never occurred. This time of communication provides also a time to really listen to the other person, to invite them to share how the broken relationship has made them feel in the past, and then again to communicate that you desire to go forward from here in a new relationship, a relationship completely unburdened by the weight of the past hurts or offenses. Asking the other person if they feel the same way, if they are ready to move forward in a new relationship. Now, ultimately, we have very little control over the decision that the other person makes. But each one of us has full control over the initiative that we take and the forgiveness that we offer. In just a moment, Pastor Lori is going to extend an invitation offered by Christ to his table. This is where we remember the sacrifice, the offering that was made at the altar for each one of us so that we would have a right relationship with God, to be at one with God. And just as Jesus reminded his disciples to consider whether there were any relationships that needed repaired before coming to worship in the temple, so we might ask ourselves today, are there any relationships, anyone God might want us to face in an effort to restore relationship? Who might we need to face before we face God at the table? As we prepare for Holy Communion, again, I'd ask you to reflect upon the name of that person with whom you desire reconciliation. Ask God for courage and strength to make plans now for the moment when you will take steps toward repairing that relationship. Then, come into the relationship that is offered by God through the person of Jesus Christ. We're nearly halfway through our journey to the cross and Holy Week this Lent. Next week, we face suffering. And as we do so, we also observe the 1-year anniversary of our church's closing because of COVID-19. And we remember this past year and the impact, the toll that COVID-19 has taken on many of us over this past year. I hope you'll join us then.
The Lord be with you. It is a good and joyful thing to give thanks to God always and everywhere. Let us pray. Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth, you brought all things into being and you called them good. From the dust of the earth, you formed us in your image. You breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. God, when rain fell upon the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, you bore up the ark on the waters, saved Noah and his family, and made covenant with every living creature on earth. When you led your people to Mount Sinai for 40 days and for 40 nights, you gave us your commandments, and you made us your covenant people. And when your people forsook your covenant, your prophet Elijah fasted for 40 days and for 40 nights. And on your holy mountain, Elijah heard your still small voice. Holy are you, God, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. When you gave Jesus to save us from our sins, your Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness where he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights to prepare for his ministry. When he suffered and died on a cross, you raised him to life, exalted him alive to the apostles during 40 days, and exalted him at your right hand. By the baptism of Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection, God, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made a new covenant, one by water and the Spirit. So now we are your people as we prepare for the yearly feast of Easter. You lead us to repentance for sin and the cleansing of our hearts. During these 40 days of Lent, may we be gifted and graced to reaffirm the covenant you made with us through Christ. And on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you and for many. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks, and he passed it to his disciples. He said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, and do so in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us where we gather, on these gifts of bread and of wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. I invite you now to the table, however it is prepared for you. This table does not belong to me or to the United Methodist Church or to Woodlawn, but this table we've prepared together belongs to God, and all are invited. Let us now partake in the elements of communion. Nourished by the bread and the unfermented wine, nourished by the Spirit of our living God, may God fill you with all faith, love, and mercy as you trust in God to go from this time together and live for him. Amen.